Hello, I am Mark Roth, the Senior Staff Software Engineer at Google. I am the technical lead for the gRPC xDS effort. In this video, I will be giving a deep dive into how we integrated xDS support into the gRPC client architecture. Before we start, let me explain the scope of this talk. This is not a talk about how to use gRPC with xDS. It's a talk about how xDS works inside the gRPC library. So while you won't come away from this talk learning how to actually do something new, I hope that you will come away with a better appreciation of how things work inside gRPC. Let's start with an introduction to xDS. xDS is a suite of APIs for configuring data plane behavior. In this context, a data plane is a piece of software that handles network traffic, such as a client, server, or proxy. The xDS APIs started as a way of configuring Envoy, which is a popular open source proxy. They were originally intended only for Envoy, but they're evolving to be more client agnostic. The goal is for xDS to be a general purpose API for configuring any data plane, whether that data plane is Envoy or gRPC or any other data plane that may come up in the future. Why is xDS useful? Here's a simple example of a typical service mesh deployment. Each compute node has both an application and an Envoy sidecar proxy. IP tables is used to ensure that all traffic to and from the application goes through Envoy. Envoy handles all of the communication between nodes. This allows Envoy to provide functionality like request routing, rate limiting, and retries without each application having to implement those features itself. So how do we get configuration to the Envoy instances in this picture? That's where xDS comes into play. When each Envoy instance comes up, the first thing it does is to contact an xDS server to get its configuration. The xDS server has a configuration about each service and knows where each node is deployed, so it can tell the Envoy instances how to talk to each other. This provides an easy way to handle horizontal scalability. As new nodes are deployed, the xDS server automatically knows about them, and all nodes always know how to talk to all other nodes. This works really well, but there is one downside. Sidecar proxies are expensive. They add CPU and memory overhead, and they increase request latency. That overhead is why we added xDS support in gRPC. Here you can see the same service mesh deployment, but instead of having a sidecar proxy on each node, the application just links against gRPC. This provides the same scalability benefits of having a centralized control plane, but without the overhead of the sidecar proxy. This is a list of the kind of features that xDS can configure. Some examples include request routing, retries, load balancing, and MTLS. This is not a comprehensive list. The xDS API is extensible, so it's easy to add new functionality over as needed, and more features are being added all the time. The xDS data model is basically a set of configuration resources. Originally, there was a separate RPC service for each resource type. The service names were of the form xDiscovery service, where x indicated the resource type. For example, for the resource type listener, the RPC service name was listener discovery service, or LDS. In gRPC, we actually use a newer variant of the RPC service that provides all resource types in one service. This is called ADS, or the aggregated discovery service. However, people still tend to refer to resource types using the original per resource type RPC service names. So if you hear somebody say LDS resource, what they really mean is a listener resource. The four main resource types in xDS are LDS for listener resources, RDS for route config resources, CDS for cluster resources, and EDS for endpoint resources. Because xDS started out as an Envoy-specific set of APIs, the best way to understand the xDS data model is to understand at least a little bit about Envoy's architecture. Envoy is split into two sides, a downstream side that listens on a port and handles incoming traffic from clients, and an upstream side that handles outgoing traffic to remote servers. So let's take a look at how traffic flows through Envoy. Traffic starts in a listener, which listens on a port for incoming IP traffic. The listener has a set of network filters used to process the incoming traffic, which provide functionality like connection level rate limiting or authorization. The final filter in this chain is the HTTP Connection Manager, or HCM. The HCM deals with HTTP level requests, so this is where we move from TCP level to HTTP level. The HCM has a set of HTTP filters that can perform per request actions, such as fault injection or per request authorization. The last HTTP filter in the chain is the router, which is the thing that connects the downstream side to the upstream side. The HCM is configured via a route configuration, which is basically a series of matching rules that determine how each HTTP request is routed. The route chosen for a given request determines two things. First, configuration parameters, such as default timeouts or retry configs. And second, which upstream cluster the request will be sent to. On the upstream side, there's basically a set of clusters. The route config determines which cluster is used for a given request, and the request is then sent to that cluster. The cluster itself has configuration for things like how to find the list of endpoints for the cluster, such as using DNS or EDS, and what LB policy to use for those endpoints. So now that you understand the Envoy architecture, you can also understand the xDS data model. The color coding here shows which resource type is used to configure which part of the system. Now, we did have some challenges adapting this data model, which was designed for a proxy, to a client-server system like gRPC. Initially, we were thinking that the upstream side would map to the client and the downstream side would map to the server, but this doesn't actually work in practice. It turns out that most of the interesting functionality that we need in the gRPC client is actually in the HCM config, such as retries or default timeouts. So this is the part that you actually need on the gRPC client. You need part of LDS and all of RDS, CDS, and EDS. We actually wound up adding a new type of listener to the XDS API to facilitate this, called an API listener, which skips the TCP filters and goes right to the HCM config. So now that I've given a basic intro to XDS, let's talk about our effort to support XDS in gRPC. This has been a pretty major effort in gRPC team. It's been going on for about 5 years and it's still under active development. We currently support XDS in 5 languages, C++, Java, Go, Python, and Node. There are 3 main parts to supporting XDS in gRPC: support for the XDS transport protocol, support for the XDS data model, and then implementing the actual features configured by XDS. This is a list of XDS-enabled features that we've implemented in gRPC, with a link to the corresponding design doc for each one. We started with basic load balancing. Soon after, we added XDS routing support and a whole slew of other client-side features. We also support security features like MTLS and RBAC, and we're always adding more, so expect this list to grow over time. So now let's talk about how we've integrated XDS support into the gRPC client architecture. And in order to do that, let me give a brief overview of that architecture. In the gRPC client channel, there are 2 types of plugins, resolvers and load balancing policies. The resolver is responsible for name resolution. When you create a gRPC channel, you specify a target URI indicating what target to connect to. The resolver is chosen based on the scheme of that target URI. It resolves the target URI to a set of addresses and an optional service config. The service config configures a number of things, amongst them which load balancing policy to use. The load balancing policy is responsible for 2 things. First, managing connections to endpoints, and second, deciding which connection each RPC will be sent on. The intention of this design was to be able to select the resolver and LB policy independently of each other. You should be able to change what name service you're using without changing the load balancing policy that you're using to distribute traffic across your endpoints. So here's how all of this fits together. When the channel starts to connect, the channel creates a resolver based on the target URI scheme. The resolver resolves the target URI and returns addresses and a service config. The channel creates an LB policy based on that service config. The LB policy then creates a set of subchannels for each endpoint. Then, for each RPC sent on the channel, the LB policy determines which subchannel to send each RPC on. So how did we integrate XDS into this existing architecture? XDS really provides both configuration and backend address info, so we needed to integrate it via both the resolver and the LB policy APIs. We added an XDS resolver to support XDS, which gets LDS and RDS data and generates the service config, and we added a whole hierarchy of LB policies. The exact layout of those policies has evolved a bit over time and will continue to do so, but it's primarily responsible for getting CDS and EDS data and handling interaction with the upstream endpoints. Both the resolver and the LB policies share a common XDS client object, which handles the communication with the XDS server. This shows the initial architecture that we used in our first XDS-capable release. We basically had a separate LB policy for each of CDS and EDS. You can see that all the communication with the XDS server goes through the shared XDS client object. With this structure, we can allow users to use XDS via the normal gRPC client channel, just by creating a channel with an XDS target URI. This architecture was fairly simple, but remember how I said that the exact layout had been evolving? This is what it looks like today. Now, I'm not going to go into this diagram in detail. I just wanted to illustrate the point that there's been a lot of churn. As we've added various features, we've run into architectural mismatches between gRPC and Envoy. This has required us to make some creative changes to our architecture in order to make everything work as expected. I want to share a couple of examples of cases where we've had to get creative like that. One example of that is figuring out how to support XDS routing. As I mentioned earlier, the XDS route config contains matching rules to determine which route to use for each RPC. The chosen route determines both which cluster to send the RPC to and what configuration should be used for the RPC, such as timeouts, retry configuration, and fault injection config. This posed a problem for us because neither our resolver nor our LB policy API had the features needed to support this. The resolver does not see the individual RPC, so it can't choose the route, but the LB policy cannot control the RPC config, and that config needs to be set before the LB policy is called. To solve this, we created a new internal API called a config selector. The idea is that the resolver returns a config selector. The channel then calls that config selector to get the config for each RPC. The XDS resolver implements a config selector that chooses the route based on the RDS data. This config selector returns a config based on the selected route and sets a call attribute to the selected cluster, which is later used by the LB policy. Another feature that required us to get a little creative was XDS HTTP filter support. This is used to support things like fault injection or RBAC authorization policies. XDS supports an ordered list of filters that process HTTP requests. Each filter has its own config, and configs can be overridden on a per-route basis. The filters run between route selection and load balancing. This posed a couple of problems for us. First, we really didn't want to add a new extension API for XDS, but we had an existing API that was similar. This is the interceptor API in Java and Go, or the filter API in C Core and Node. The second problem was we didn't have any extension point at the right place in our code path. To fix that, we added the ability to run these interceptors or filters in between the config selector and the LB policy. Those are just a couple of examples of cases where we had to adapt our architecture to support XDS. There are other examples as well. If you're interested in details, you can read the gRPCs for the various XDS features. If you have questions, feel free to ask them on the gRPC.io mailing list. Thank you very much, and I hope you have found this talk interesting.